Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I welcome you to St. Andrew's United Methodist Church's traditional worship service. This particular service has hymns and a children's message and communion. If you would like a shorter worship service, there's also a service called the Kiss Service, keeping it shorter and simpler. You can find that on the web too. Hope you've had a great week. It really has been a good week for many of our people. We continue to hear more and more folks that are getting shots, and that is fantastic. That's going to offer the ability for folks to come back to worship and to feel safe. And so that is really a blessing. Thanks to Ed and his team that's taking care of that in Virginia Beach. We've had a few people that have been in and out of the hospital. If you're interested in praying for those people by name and you haven't received the information on them, simply send us in the office your information, and we'll be glad to share those with you. We're not going to post them actually on the web. If you're worshiping with us and you're not on our mailing list, we sure would love to know who you are so that when we email things out, we can get them to you. And so we'd love for you to supply that information to us. There will be a mailing coming out in a couple weeks. Inside that will be a cross made from a palm frond. And that also will be the first Sunday. At this point, we're planning on being back for in-person worship at 10 o'clock on the 28th. And so that's just great, great news. Some of the restrictions have been lifted. And so if you've gotten the shots or if you feel safe, we'd love to see you. And I can't wait to see some of you that I haven't seen in just a whole year. It's hard to believe. Anyway, thank you for your financial support. We were down a little bit this past month. That's kind of normal for February. But thank you. We're doing some great ministries. And only by your tithe sacrifice and sacrifices, you know, is that possible. And so thanks for the offerings. You have three ways that you can contribute to the ministries of the church. You can mail it to us at 717 Tucson Road, Virginia Beach, Virginia 23462. You can go on the web to our website, saumcvb.org. Or you can drive it up and stick it up here in the box. By the way, the jonquils are starting to show up, and so that's absolutely gorgeous. Hope you're having a great one. Glad you're here to worship. Tell you what, let's begin our time of worship by just taking a couple moments to center ourselves on Christ. Let us pray.
call to worship. We continue our Lenten season of recovery as we focus on health as essential to our spiritual lives. Vessels, holy and whole. Broken, needing the one. Open, body and soul. Healer, come.
Those who collect beach glass often become archaeologists, seeking out any markings or clues as to the story of the original piece. It often takes much time to bring out the truth behind it. This week, we acknowledge the power of truth-telling as a healing property. There are stories that have shaped our lives, leaving us without the ability to see who we truly are in the eyes of God, and leaving us without the ability to speak the depth of our stories of struggle. We focus on the importance of recovery of mental health, reclaiming our sense of who we are and being able to proclaim with new redemptive stories our divine worth. Vessels, holy and whole, broken, needing the one, open, body and soul, come, healer, come.
Let us acknowledge our need for restoration, repair, and renewal of our holy vessels, which include the communities of which we are a part. Let us pray. Centering and calming divine breath of God, you gifted us with amazing minds, capable of so many things. You gave us the ability to think and feel, filling us with discernment of thought and emotion. Like our physical bodies, sometimes this aspect of self is compromised. We struggle under the strains of disappointment, despair, and delusion. Too often we hide our struggles, afraid of what others might think of our difficulties in managing or moving forward, even in the face of devastating circumstances. Too often, we perpetuate the stigma of a less than perfect state of mind by shaming ourselves and others. Millennia of misunderstanding compounds our fear. We label and belittle others while turning the hatred upon ourselves, for no one is immune from troubles of the mind at some point. God, so many are suffering now. They are weary and distraught, grieving, and at the end of their rope. We cannot fathom the amount of loss, and so we look away. Sometimes we even look away from the need within our own communities. Help us, healer. Show us our capacity for compassion. Forgive our inattention. Move us to move one step at a time toward greater care for one another.
And now, in this silence, let us sense and acknowledge our yearning for wholeness. Vessels, holy and whole, broken, needing the one, open, body and soul. Healer, come. Healer, come.
I invite you to imagine and search for warmth at the core of your body. It may help to keep your eyes closed. This warm orb of light is deep within you, although sometimes it feels dulled, even cold. If it feels this way now, allow this. Do not judge yourself. Perhaps you do feel this warmth, and all feels right with the world. This just is. You likely will not always feel that way. Whether or not you feel the warmth of peace and assurance right now, this does not make you right or wrong, good or bad. It just makes you human, and you are not alone. Perhaps you can imagine the warmth coming from someone whose presence fills you with comfort. See it radiate from them to you as it does when you need it most. Know this, you are accepted, no matter what. Accepting the truth of our difficulties is part of the journey of recovery. Sharing our stories of difficulty can open the way for healing. For you, for me, for all. Take a deep breath in to let this truth fill you, and breathe out with the relief of assurance.
Good morning. You know, one of my very favorite things to do is to read stories, to tell stories, to hear stories, to know your stories. And when I was a child, a lot of the stories began with these words, "Once upon a time." And they ended with these words, "And they all lived happily ever after, the end." None of those stories went like this. Once upon a time, there were three little pigs. They all lived happily ever after, the end. That's not a story. They left out the most important part. They left out the middle. It's the exciting part while all the huffing and puffing and houses being blown down happens. It's where our heroines and our heroes are going to scary places, encountering scary creatures, where bad things happen to good people or hard things happen to good people. It's a place where our heroes and our heroines overcome obstacles, the things that get in their way. Speaking of overcoming, you ever worn one of these? Or one of these on your elbow? On your knee, on your forehead? Well, each of these bandages tells a story. Whether it's a little boo-boo or a big scrape, it feels better when someone we love, or maybe we can even take care of it ourselves, puts a bandage on it. That bandage, the story that it tells others is, that you've been hurt, but you overcame it and you're now much better. It says, hey, I've been through something painful, but I'm okay. Sometimes my kids would wear bandages far longer than I thought they needed to. But I think it's because of the stories that bandages tell. Every time somebody sees a bandage, they say, "What happened to you?" And you get a chance to tell your story and how you overcame the pain. Stories are powerful. The Bible is filled with stories of God's people overcoming challenges. Our faith is full of stories. Our very church communities is filled with people who have stories. Great stories. Impressive stories. Let's keep telling our stories and listen to the stories of others, because our stories help us to get through tough times. As we complete this tough year of hard things happening, maybe the year ahead will be one of healing, and at the end of it, we'll be able to tell our story of overcoming. But throughout this year, it is such a wonderful reassurance to know that we can always call upon God, that we can always go to Him in prayer for ourselves and for others. God always hears our prayers. God always listens. Loving God, we come to you with hearts, with hands, with minds, and with souls in need of your healing touch. Heal us from the inside so that we may reach out to help heal your world. Amen.
Prayer for illumination. There is no greater agony than bearing an untold story inside you. Help us open ourselves to hear your story, O Lord. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 9th chapter, the 27th through the 33rd verses. As Jesus went on from there, two blind men followed him, crying loudly, "Have mercy on us, Son of David." When he entered the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said to them, "Do you believe that I am able to do this?" They said to him, "Yes, Lord." Then he touched their eyes and said, "According to your faith, let it be done to you." And their eyes were opened. Then Jesus sternly ordered them, "See that no one knows of this." But they went away and spread the news about him throughout that district. After they had gone away, a demoniac who was mute was brought to him. And when the demon had been cast out, the one who had been mute spoke. And the crowds were amazed and said, "Never has anything like this been seen in Israel." The written word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
On the front of our bulletin, which you can download on the website if you wish to have a copy of it, there's a statement there from Marcia McPhee, which has a couple things in it that I wanted to point out to you that I found very interesting. The blind men were able to see for the first time, as were the people who were around Jesus. They were able to see things for the very first time too. And if you listen carefully to the reading, if you listened carefully to the reading or you go back and read it, you'll find that the people say, "Never have we seen anything like this." And yet neither of them really saw what happened. They both had impressions, and the impressions left them, quite frankly, not seeing the truth, not seeing the full story. And so I ask you a question. What has God allowed you to see this week for the first time? What has God allowed you this week to see for the first time? You know, being able to see our story more clearly is one of the first steps in improving our mental health. Most of us don't see our story honestly. We don't know it very well. Oftentimes the stories that we've told us, that we've told ourselves, are stories that are not really congruent with what happened at all. You know, it's sort of like Elizabeth and I were married not very long, and we were driving down the road one day trying to get somewhere, and I passed by a street that I wanted to turn on, and I said, "Why in the world don't they make these signs large enough that you can see them from a distance? Why do you have to be on top of them in order to see them?" And she said, "You can't see them until you're on top of them." I said, "No." She said, "I think you need to go see an eye doctor." So I went to see an ophthalmologist, and sure enough, he said, "You have astigmatism." He made me up a glass prescription. I got them. I remember the first time I put them on. Well, on Facebook this week, I saw a little baby, maybe 6 months old, that for the first time received glasses. And the baby's face just lit up, and I thought about the first time that I got glasses. I remember saying to myself, "My goodness, look at all the things that you missed." I've talked with people that have gotten hearing aids before, and it's interesting how they say, you know, how much they had forgotten. There's a great commercial right now on TV where a man and a woman pull up to a place and they're ordering, and the lady is telling the man what it is that she wants, and back and forth. And finally, at the end, she understands that he's not ordering at all what she wants. And it's humorous, and it's not humorous, because it's very painful for people that can't hear well, that can't see well. I got a new pair of glasses a couple weeks ago, these things that I'm wearing, and I've ordered a new pair of lenses even yet since then to replace these because they're not servicing me like I would like them to. I understand what it means to see things from an improper perspective or a poor perspective. I went to Niagara Falls years ago, and I've talked with people about it who have been since, and over and over I've heard, which side did you go to, the Canadian side or the U.S. side? And I said, the U.S., and they said, oh, no, you got to go to the Canadian side. The perspective from there is so much better. Maybe so. Next time I go, I'll carry my passport, and if we're allowed to transfer over to the other side, I'll go over and take a look. You know, there's an old story about four blind guys that approach an elephant. The first guy that speaks is out front, and he has a hold of the trunk, and he says, "This certainly is a brand new breed of snake." To which the guy standing beside the ear, as he's holding this ear, he said, "No, I think it's a strange bird with floppy, weird wings." The blind guy standing beside the elephant was touching it as it was moving slightly, and he said, I don't think so. He said, "I think it's some sort of strange living wall." The fourth guy happened to be over against the beast's leg, and he said, "No, this is a tree that moves." Well, they all were correct, but they were all wrong also. Of course, we know it's an elephant, but their perspective certainly was correct for what they saw, for what they thought they knew. And so, perspective is most everything in understanding. And one's faith is key component to the perspective. And thus, our stories that we tell ourselves inform our understanding of life. And they're powerful and they grow over time. And as we re-etch those over and over and over in our being, they become the ethos through which we view ourselves, others, the world, God. They become the narrative that seals the teller's mind. Oftentimes, they're contained only inside of the mind of the teller. They're not shared. You know, I want to give you three lines from different stories and see if you know these. These have been sealed in the mind of many people. You may not know them all. Why is this night different from all other nights? There were three little pigs. When what to my wondering eye did appear, but we tell ourselves stories to better understand life. Stories are narratives are distinctly ours. Others may have very closely related stories to ours, variants of our stories, but they're never exactly the same as our narratives. Even people who live through the same situation will have slightly different, or maybe largely different, variants on the same narrative, the same story. You know, my children, they used to love to sit at my dad's feet when we would be on vacation and just listen to his stories for hours. Many of the stories I've heard over and over and over, and they've heard over and over, and yet there was something about hearing those stories again and again that just made them giggle and laugh. And if they could find inside of those stories a story about me when I was their age, where I just really messed up, it was just the greatest thing in the world, and they would crack up. Most of the time, we don't know other people's stories very well. Sometimes we think we do, but we don't. nor do they know our narratives. But when we tell our story, when we hear another person's story, the teller is seen by the hearer differently from that point forward, if they can hear it. A change of perspective takes place. Unless we fully understand the complete narrative, we misunderstand the meaning of the situation and life surrounding that person and the way that they view it, and quite frankly, the way we view it completely. This certainly has been a year where anyone with a tender heart has had to listen to the narratives of other people, other peoples. We don't understand other people's narratives very well. We don't understand other people's perspectives very well, and thus we don't understand how it is that they view the world and why they act the way they act. But if we can get into that, we can certainly understand and be able to maybe commiserate, maybe just simply. You know, Jesus had a great fear of that happening, that folks would hear a story from his actions, would see a narrative in his life, and that they would experience that something and think that they understood the meaning of what was going on, but actually they would completely misunderstand the action and the meaning. Jesus was very frightened that this would happen. In fact, he knew that it was happening. No doubt you'll remember back a few weeks ago we talked about, what was called the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew. You know, something that I would recommend you do this week, take your Bible and read Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, the Sermon on the Mount, and then continue reading 8 and 9, five chapters, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 5, 6, 7, you've got the Sermon on the Mount. And in the midst of that story, you have these three guys that have gone up with Jesus, and Elijah and Moses show up, and they're having a conversation. These three guys are frightened. They're confused. And then they begin to talk about, one of them begins to talk about building booths and finding a way to, he's just jabbering, and suddenly a cloud comes over top of them, and then there's the voice, the same voice that was at Jesus' baptism. Look, this is a guy, my son, the man. I'm proud of him. Please stop talking and listen to him. Please stop talking and listen to him, because you don't understand what's going on. And suddenly, the cloud's gone, the voice is gone, the guys are gone, and there's just the four of them standing there, Jesus and the three. And as Jesus comes down off the mountain, he turns to them and he says, please, don't tell anyone about this. Implication? You don't understand what happened here. I know you think you do, but you don't. The feeding of the 5,000. Jesus makes it clear in his comments to one of the groups that shows up, you missed the point. You're all here because you got fed over there. But that wasn't the point. You didn't hear my words. And he seems rather upset about it. The walking on the water. I got to say that the guys in the boat probably were confused, but little did they understand what it was that was happening because he was walking on the water. He was trying to teach them something that was not going to become clear until after his life, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. The three people that we've talked about over the past few weeks, the healings in 5, 6, and 7, Sermon on the Mount, coming down off the mountain, then we have this listing of healings. There's 10 of them, reminiscent of Moses back years ago having the 10 plagues. Now we have the 10 healing stories. And we talked about the opening ones, that of the leper. The people saw it. They thought they knew what was going on, but they didn't. The leper received the healing, and Jesus says to him, don't tell anyone about this. Just go and take yourself over to the priest and do what you need to do there so you can get reintegrated into society, into the community of faith. Of course, he can't. He can't. The folks there can't keep the story, and he can't keep the story. The centurion's servant, the healing there, same thing. Those there were confused by the elements. We talked about that a couple weeks ago. But even more than that, nobody understood really what the healing was about. There are other healings that take place. Peter's mother-in-law, the healing that happens there. And she begins to get up and to serve. And nobody there really understood what was happening. You know, and today we're presented with the two blind men. They saw Jesus' divinity before the rest of the crowd did. They saw things before the crowd did. And they called out, "Son of David." Well, it's the same thing that Bartimaeus calls out. It's the same thing that many of these people call out. It's a term which means Messiah or Lord. It's a way of identifying Jesus as being that one pivotal man in history. They saw the possibilities of healing before others that were standing with them. Frankly, they probably saw the possibility before the others even saw the need for it. Well, that's an interesting thing about people, but we're rather self-centered, self-focused. Me and mine, and so we see the needs that we have before we see the needs of others. And quite frankly, that becomes part of the problem with the healings, is that the folks who receive the healings may very well be thinking that the healing is for them, when quite frankly, it's for them and it's for other people. That's the problem. We get stuck on writing our own narratives. We pay little attention to others, and thus we see no need to hear their stories of pain and need. And in doing so, we quite literally build walls around ourselves and other people's, and then we can't figure out why we have difficult times communicating with each other, understanding each other. Jesus was more than a healer of the blind. And ultimately, the blind needed more than a physical sight. Yes, without a doubt, they had need to have their eyes open, but they needed more than that. They needed to be healed. They needed to be made whole. Often our pain, it becomes a filter or a distraction in our lives, and it leaves us. It leaves us really missing that which needs to be touched in our lives. We see the thing that feels like it's the main thing that needs to be touched, like the blind men. Needed their sight returned to them, but they needed so much more. They needed to be touched in ways that they weren't in the moment. And quite frankly, the crowd around Jesus as he did these healings one after another left them partially healed, but not whole. The wholeness would not come until Jesus died and came back to life. You know, what has God allowed you to see for the first time this week? The real question, I think, is, do we want to see God as God sees? Do we want to see God as God sees? Or do we want to create a God who sees as we see? Much of what Jesus did was to help the disciples to understand the story of God, to understand their real story in God's story. Much of what Jesus did was to help them understand God's story and their story in God's story. But in Jesus telling God's full story through his life, some got stuck on the first and the second chapter and never read the rest of the book. Some saw the healings, the walking on the water, the feedings, as the reason for Jesus coming into the world. When what those things were spotlights. They were the Facebook of the time, the Instagram of the time, the Twitter of the time, where it showed something and it just went like wildfire out so that they focused on this man. And then when this man went to Jerusalem and was arrested and beaten and crucified and then raised from the dead, that shining spotlight on him went from elation of him going into town with the palms to despair of him being arrested and beaten, to fear and cries as he's crucified, to complete elation as he's raised from the dead. And then all of the things that he did before suddenly come into better focus. But quite frankly, not clear focus. Even today, folks misunderstand the message of God. If we get stuck on chapters 1 and 2, we never hear the complete narrative. And we miss the reason for the life of the God-man. The story was God created you. And God created everyone else. The story was God loves you. And God loves everyone else. The story was God cares for you. And God cares for everyone else. The story was God cares for all in every season, in every time, and in every place. Psalm 139. Where can I go to escape you, O Lord? If I go, you're there. If I go, you're there. If I go, you're there. I have a family member that writes me things, or used to write me things occasionally on the net about disdain for Muslims and that you can't trust them and that all of them are here to hurt us and on and on. And I didn't handle it very well a couple times, you know, where I sent a thing back and I said, please just don't send me this kind of garbage. Certainly there are some that are problematic, but not all are. And God loves all of them. Yeah, God loves all people of all nations. God loves all races, all nationalities. God loves all. God cares for all. Jesus Christ came into the world for all. God is attempting to bring all people back to relationship, to regenerate all folks back into what God wanted them to be, to bring the kingdom of God into this world. God wants to walk with you. God wants to heal you. God wants to rewrite your story based on truth. Not only so you may see in this world, but so that you may see who the Messiah really is in this world, and you may be filled with God's word and live as a person of hope, of love, of joy, of peace, of faith, of grace. Through faith, all of these things, the perspective is changed with the faith in Jesus Christ. It changes our perspective, and thus we see everything inside of us and everything outside of us differently. It's not until we experience the gift of Christ's life, death, burial, and resurrection that we see clearly. The charismatic content, life, death, burial, resurrection, In Matthew, all of these things, Jesus says, please don't tell people, please don't tell people, please don't tell people. Because he understands that if they share the narrative that they think that they experienced, they will miss the full understanding that Jesus brings into the world through his life, his death, his burial, his resurrection. These things change our perspective and thus change. They change our brokenness to beauty. To be able to see God, to see that God loves us more, it's a change in image. Right now, why don't you call out to God so that you may better recognize who God is? You may better recognize who you are, who I am, who we are, and who others are. Why don't you call out to God? What is God wanting to help you see better today? What do you need to hear? What do you need healing of? Amen. Amen.
The prayers of the people. Please light your candle during the prayers of the people. Healer of our every ill, especially our malady of stigmatized fear of mental illness, we come before you to make our petitions known. Hear our cries for the healing of body, mind, and spirit. We know that already you are at work among us, showing us the way to recovery from the toxicities and grief of our time. You have stamped each one of us as worthy. We give you thanks that your mercy is wide and your faithfulness does not depend upon having our feelings sorted out or our sense of well-being secure. You are not waiting for us to get our act together before offering us your love and grace. We pray especially for those who have experienced heightened and acute mental and emotional difficulties as a result of this past year of isolation and fear. We pray for those who feel far from hope, and we mourn those who cannot find a lifeline to survive this hardship. We pray for those who find themselves without access to adequate care, someone to talk to, or appropriate resources to steady their hearts and minds. We give thanks for those who are telling their stories, showing us how to open our hearts to help others, and offering ripples of healing in the community. We pray thanks for progress toward holistic health care and the efforts of all who are working to destigmatize mental illness, making it easier to ask for and get the help so desperately needed. We ask for courage and encouragement to reevaluate how we as a church can help now and into the future. We pray silently this day for the needs of others. In your love, make us whole. May we rest in your compassion. Calm the lost, weary soul in the warmth of your love. May your peace fill our hearts. May we know the love of Jesus. By your grace, you console. Make us holy. Make us whole. Amen.
Christ our Lord invites to his table all those who love him, all who earnestly repent of their sins and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and before one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We've rebelled against your love. We've not loved our neighbors, and we've not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray silently for our sins. hear the gospel, the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let us take a moment to place a blessing upon the offerings that we've received, symbolic by these plates, the ones that we've received through the mail, through the internet, and physically dropped off. Let us pray over them as they're sent into the world. Amen. Would you join me in the doxology? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Would you join me in the prayer of dedication? Generous God, we give thanks for all that you have given us. We return from it an offering for the sake of spreading your love as the body of Christ. Open us, Lord, to even better ways to steward your creation under our care. Help us to aid you and bring your kingdom into this world. In the name of Christ Jesus, we offer this prayer. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. The night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, he raised it, blessed it, broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took a cup, a new cup, an additional cup. He raised it, gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of a new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, O Lord, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, O Lord, and on these gifts of bread and wine here and those at home. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the whole world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, honor and glory is yours now and forever. Amen. Now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Make this be for us a means of grace, Lord. Amen. May this be for us a sign and a symbol of your sacrifice and a call for ours. Amen. You may receive your elements at home. They have been blessed. Let us join in singing the closing hymn. There is a balm in Gilead. go into the world empowered by the Spirit of God and be people of God who are better understanding their story, have open ears to hear other stories, are better understanding God's story and how you fit inside it. Go and do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a wonderful week.